If the first time, let me know what state you're from. Let's start on this side, state or country. You all?
Georgia.
All Georgia. What part?
Atlanta.
Florida, okay.
Gainesville.
Gainesville.
Thomasville.
Any others?
New Jersey.
New Jersey?
Missouri.
Okay. Teaching there, I meet with the deans and professors, a small group of them every month, and also I meet with the president of the university for an hour and a half each month to talk about the interrelationships between the Carter Center, where Rosalind and I do our work, and the university itself. It provides us with kind of a foundation of academic and research, and we provide them with a foundation of international action. So that's a very that's what I did this past week. My lecture this week was to the public health, future public health doctors, and to an anthropology department about the interrelationship among people and how taking care of individual health, about which we heard in a beautiful prayer, does contribute to the interrelationship of people within a country and also between nations, because I don't see any way to separate the basic elements that create a quality of life. And to summarize, those would be justice and peace and freedom and democracy and human rights and environmental equality and the alleviation of suffering. But they're all intimately interrelated. You can't separate peace, for instance, from the alleviation of suffering, because when people do suffer because of deprivation or despair or lack of self-confidence or hopelessness or starvation, they tend to lash out, quite often in anger or sometimes just to protect their own families, against their own leaders and create a civil war, or in a spirit of envy or despair against people that they now see much more frequently with globalization of communications and information in other countries, and they feel like somehow they have been deprived. So that was what I lectured on this past week. This happens to be the 20th anniversary of the Carter Center. And also, we're going to go to Norway next month for an award. And so, I had in just one day, I had 17 interviews. I think 14 of them were on radio, and the other four were television. One was newspaper. But so we are involved in letting people know what the Carter Center has been doing for the last 20 years and what we expect to do in the future. So we stay quite busy on that 1 4-week in Atlanta, and we generally go up in additional times during the other 3 weeks, either overseas or to Atlanta to do our work. And that's what we did last week. This week we'll be going up to Washington tomorrow. President Bush is having a reception for all the Nobel laureates. So I'll be meeting with the others from the United States that have been chosen in the past, not just for peace, but for chemistry and physics and medicine and literature this year and also in previous years. And then the ambassadors of both Sweden and Norway are having official receptions for us. And as you may or may not know, Alfred Nobel died about 1895. He was the inventor of dynamite. Before that, they had nitroglycerin, which was almost impossible to contain. His brother was killed in an explosion in their family explosives manufacturing plant, and he concentrated a good portion of his life on the invention of dynamite, which is a much safer material. As you know, you can go to a farm supply store, which my father used to do a lot, and I've done a few times, and just buy a case of dynamite. It's quite safe until you very seriously are determined to set it off. But anyway, the enormous fortune that he inherited or earned from dynamite, he deeded to establish a fund from which the income would go for Nobel Prizes. So at that time, Norway and Sweden were united in one country. Nobel was from Sweden. So he decided that the chemistry and physics and medicine and literature awards would be given in Sweden and the Peace Award for some reason in Norway. And that's the way in town, so we'll be doing that this week. And then after we get through with those ceremonies, I'll also be meeting with some of the leaders in Washington to talk about some of the international problems that face our country. One would be North Korea, where Rosa and I went back in 1994, 8 years ago, to try to defuse a potential war in the peninsula, the Korean Peninsula. And it's generating again now to a confrontation between North Korea and the outside world. These are very strange people who we got to know to some degree in our visit. And they're paranoid. They think the rest of the world is against them, and they have a powerful military capability. In fact, it's the fourth largest military in the world. And they are only 35 miles from Seoul, South Korea. So with a lightning strike, if they wanted to, they could create a great deal of damage in South Korea. So the easing of those tensions and the prevention of war is a very important thing, not only for us and the people in Korea, but also for the rest of the world. So we'll be having some meetings next week on that subject as well. After that, we're going to meet with two of our friends from our presidential years. Jody Powell was my press secretary, and Frank Moore was the one that related between the White House and the Congress. So they have a nice place on the Chesapeake Bay, and every year we try to go there and spend just a few days getting reacquainted and relaxing and getting away from telephones and looking at the outdoor world, doing some fishing and so forth. That's what we're going to do. We'll be back next Saturday, I think. Isn't that right, Rosie? She said, I hope. So that's this past week and what we anticipate this week. We're continuing along, and I don't know, I started to say tedious. I'll withdraw my thought about tedious. But a long and sustained study in the Old Testament. We've been doing this now for, Mashuk, 9 or 10 months, haven't we? A long time, since early this year. And I think throughout the rest of this month, we'll be studying in the Old Testament a history of the Hebrew people, the relationship between them and God, the ministry of the prophets that came to them, the consequences of that turning away from the covenant that had been ordained between God and the Hebrew leaders. When was the first major covenant established, anyone, and with whom?
Abraham.
Abraham. And about what year was that? More or less.
5,700.
I mean?
5,700.
It was about 2,000 years before Christ. And then the next covenant was reaffirmed, the same covenant, by the way, basic covenant. With whom? I'd say with Moses, when the Israelites had gone into captivity in Egypt, and God reconfirmed the covenant with Moses. And anybody know about when that was? I generally say 1500, but nobody knows. About 1500. So you can remember those 2 days, 2000 B.C., 1500 B.C. And the next covenant, I would say, was reconfirmed with King David and his son Solomon, and that was about 1000 B.C. And then came a fragmentation of the Hebrew people into two kingdoms. The northern kingdom was called what? It was called Israel, and the southern kingdom was called what?
Judah.
And the king and the capital of Judah was what? Jerusalem. And Israel? Samaria. Very good class. Well, about roughly 700 or so B.C. came the downfall of a northern kingdom. Assyria conquered the northern kingdom. And we studied a lot about that in the early months of this year. As the people turned away from God, they forgot or abandoned the covenant. They deliberately worshipped false gods. They created sacrilege in the holy temple, in their worship places. They created worship places out in the woods and in trees and to sexual objects and handmade little idols to God. So the Assyrians overtook Israel, the northern kingdom, which had how many different places were in the northern kingdom? Tribes. 10. And in the southern kingdom, 2 left, right? Judah and what?